Again, what are you looking for as you go through these metrics? Joe Biden gets 85% of this new batch of ballots, just shy of 3,000 votes.
John King was the man at CNN's Magic Wall. He kept America and the world informed state by state, county by county on election night, and then the day after election night, and then the night after that. And it kept going like that until Saturday, November 7th at 11:24 a.m. Eastern Standard Time.
CNN projects Joseph R. Biden Jr. is elected the 46th president of the United States, winning the White House and denying President Trump a second term.
CNN became the first major news organization to call it, projecting Joe Biden as the next president of the United States of America. But the story isn't over, and joining us to talk about all of it is the host of Inside Politics and CNN's chief national correspondent, John King. John, welcome, and I hope you've had a chance to finally get some sleep.
No sleep, Frank. As you mentioned, the story's not over yet. So sleep will come in hopefully days to a week or so, because the drama continues.
It sure does, and we're going to get into that in a second. But I want to ask you the most important question first, and that is, who is cooler? Is it you or Steve Kornacki over at MSNBC?
You know, I don't know Steve, which is sad. I guess he's from Massachusetts as well as I am, so he's a Red Sox fan. Sorry, Dodger fans. But I have nothing but respect. I know what it's like to have that responsibility on election night, and I know how both exciting and how challenging it can be. And so I have great respect for him, but of course I'm cool with Frank.
Well, let's get into that responsibility that you talk about and the call to project to Joe Biden as the winner of the election. First of all, what goes into making that decision?
We have a great team of people who spend literally months on this. What is the metric going to be in every state? Now, normally, at the end, you're down to the battleground states. But you build a set of metrics, and what does any candidate need to get across the finish line? And so I'm involved in the pre-process, but on election days, I say election days because this one went on for a week, I'm not in direct communication with them because I need to be walled off because I'm on live television. If I know they're about to do something, then it might influence my reporting or what I'm saying on television. So I'm walled off on election day, but I know the team and I know the process, and it's very solid. It's very cautious. And so if you think through it, we had Tuesday night, then Wednesday. We knew we weren't going to be able to call it then. I thought Thursday or Friday we might get there. Those became almost like Groundhog Day because we weren't getting many new votes. And then Saturday morning when we came in very early, I knew from past experience that we were getting close, and then they got to the point where they were willing to call it. But it's a very conservative, cautious process. And even though by late Friday it was pretty clear Biden was going to get there, you can't break the rules. So you have to wait till you reach your metric to go over the line, and that's what happened a little before noon here in the East on Saturday.
Well, just so I understand the conservative approach, some were suggesting that CNN and maybe even some other news organizations were being super conservative because the nature of this presidency, and that with any other president, they would have called it earlier. Is there any truth to that?
I don't believe that. I think you have to factor into your decision when you're doing this job any day of the week, that we live in an age where we are constantly attacked and questioned and our credibility challenged by the President of the United States. It's not unusual to have the media in the spotlight. It is unusual for a president to have it as sort of his daily go-to. So you have to be aware of that. But that's actually the reason to have rules, right? So that they can't be influenced by anything. As we built up the case, again, Friday night, it was pretty clear Biden was going to get there, but he had not met the mathematical probability yet, and you just can't bend the rules. You just can't.
There is obviously a weight attached to everything you do when you go on the air and you're trying to inform the American people, and in the case of CNN, people are watching around the world to learn if there's going to be a new president. You have to get this right. Take us through your job in those moments. And what was your mission beginning on election night, specifically with the Magic Wall?
Well, my job is to be right, if you boil it all down. My job has to be right, because especially on election night, what you're seeing in the Magic Wall is a live data feed. I don't know what's coming. I have no idea. States are counting votes. States are reporting votes. I could be talking about some place that's blue because Biden's leading, and while I'm talking, it changes to red. So I have to be able to react to that. So part of it is preparation. And part of it is understanding the moment. And again, that's why the responsibility that CNN gives me I'm grateful for it. I take it quite seriously. The Magic Ball gives me a vehicle to take people places. I use the map. Let's go to Ohio. Let's go to this place in Pennsylvania. It also gives me a chance to show them as things change right through it. And because this election was so unprecedented, three different ways to vote. Vote by mail, stand in line and vote early, show up on election day. Different states were going to count those ballots in different order. And we knew from all the data before us, mail-in ballots were going to be disproportionately Biden. The election day vote was going to be disproportionately Trump. Early voting was more mixed, depending on what state. But we had to know not only what votes we had, but which votes they were, which is why on election night, Joe Biden jumps out to a big lead in Ohio. Joe Biden jumps out to a big lead in Texas. Democrats are thinking, wow, it is a big blue wave. It was my job to say, be careful, slow down. We're in the early chapters here because they counted the mail ballots first, those states. The flip side was Trump pulls ahead to a huge lead in Pennsylvania. And my job was to say, slow down. If you're a Trump supporter, don't start doing handstands yet. You know, this is only a piece of the picture. It was real. I didn't like the term mirage. Some people said red mirage, blue mirage. I didn't like that term because it implies fake. A mirage is fake. It was real. It just wasn't the full piece of the pie. And so part of my job was to be the voice of caution.
You talk about that changing nature of the information coming in, and people watching you, they would see you talk about specific counties as if you had been there. And having worked with you at CNN, I know your legendary work ethic. I know how long you've been doing this. It didn't surprise me at all, but I think it surprised a lot of folks. And they think, how did that guy know how to say that about this particular county or that particular area? How do you know all that stuff?
There's some advantage to having gray or white hair. A lot of it is experience, in the sense that I've been blessed, both at my job at CNN and before that at the Associated Press, to have bosses who accepted my view of the challenge, which is you can't cover American politics by being in Washington, because Washington is not America. I learned this in my first campaign back in 1988. I was a kid who grew up in Boston, and we didn't have much money growing up. I didn't travel all that much, and all of a sudden I was being introduced to America, and you're in West Virginia, and then the next day you're in Indiana, and then you're in Colorado, and then you're in California. And it's so different, and it's so diverse, and it's so amazing and wonderful, but challenging when it comes to the politics. You know, the people of Los Angeles are different than the people of Omaha, Nebraska. They're all great people. They just think differently. They vote differently sometimes. And so the experience of covering 9 presidential campaigns is part of what I'm doing at the Magic Wall. I've been to most of those places. I've been to all 50 states, most of them many times, the key battleground states dozens and dozens of times. And in those key counties that you know are going to make the difference in the states, I try to visit them whenever I can. So some of that is my life. Some of that is my life, coming out through my hands on election night, and I'm blessed to have had those opportunities to travel. And then the rest of it is, especially in this year, where COVID did impact the ability to travel, and my job is a little different, so I can't travel as much anyway, is just doing some homework, studying the election, reading a lot of local newspapers, listening to local radio interviews with candidates, and then looking at, whether it's census data or state economic data, where are people moving, where are they shifting, where's the economy strong, where is it weak, those kind of things.
I know you're confident in the projection that CNN made that Joe Biden is the president-elect. Other news organizations are just as confident. Democrats are confident. Many Republicans are confident. And yet you have the president of the United States, Donald Trump, continuing to suggest that this election was stolen from him. Is there any evidence at all to suggest that?
No, there's not. There's none. And look, the president has every right to pursue any legal recourse to challenge any conduct he thinks is wrong. In all of these state lawsuits that they put in so far, judges have essentially laughed them out of the room. I've covered politics for a long time. If you see evidence of fraud, you're going to see it right before an election, on election day, or you're going to pick up on it from somebody right after. Now, the clock is ticking on this. Again, the president has every right to follow and pursue any legal resource. But, Frank, they're talking about, suing in Michigan. He lost Michigan by 148,000 plus votes. I'm sorry, you might find 10 here, 20 there. You might even find a couple hundred that you can question, right? But you're not going to overturn a lead of 150,000 votes. It's just not going to happen. And so most judges have been pushing their cases out. Again, we'll see where it goes. The most damning thing to me from the perspective of what the president is saying is this organization of watchdogs, secretaries of state, other elections officials, including people at the Trump Department of Homeland Security, issued a report late in the week saying this was the most secure election in American history and that there were no votes changed. There was no evidence of widespread fraud. So even people on the president's payroll said he's simply not telling the truth.
Many Republicans refuse to suggest to the president that he accept these results. They refuse to say it publicly. What are they saying privately? We're going to take a short break. We're going to ask John King about that. And we're going to ask him about President Obama and what he told 60 Minutes. We're back with John King, the host of Inside Politics on CNN, the chief national correspondent for CNN. John, Republicans have largely, at least publicly, not accepted the results of this election. What are they saying privately?
That Joe Biden's the next president of the United States, and they know it. And the math is, you know, the math is just undeniable. And that, again, you know, there's just no way. The president would have to flip three states, Frank, at least three states, depending on the size, the electoral college votes of those states. He would have to reverse the results in three states to somehow win re-election. So that's not going to happen. But privately, they tell you that. Publicly, they won't. Most of them won't. Some of them starting to crack as we got late in the week. But most of them won't because simply fear. Number one, the president did get more than 70 million votes. He is going to be a powerful force, the most powerful force in the Republican Party for the foreseeable future. And in the short term, Republicans very much want his help in this Georgia runoffs, two Senate seats that will be in January, early January, that will decide whether the Democrats or the Republicans control the Senate. The Republicans want to keep the majority in the United States Senate. Therefore, they want to stay in the president's good favor.
Many people are worried about this short-term political calculus that's going on with regard to the election results. Former President Obama among them. Here's what he told 60 Minutes on a program that's airing this weekend. The president saying, I'm more troubled by the fact that other Republican officials who clearly know better are going along with this and are humoring him in this fashion. He goes on to say, it is one more step in delegitimizing not just the incoming Biden administration, but democracy generally. And that's a dangerous path. Is he wrong?
No, he's not wrong. It is a dangerous path. Look, we have to put on the table here. There's a long history between President Obama and President Trump. President Obama has a lot of hard feelings for President Trump because of the whole Bertha controversy. So he enjoys, President Obama does, getting into these fights, picking these fights with President Trump. You cannot set that aside. However, to his general point here, look, the president lost the election. And yet the president continues to lie to his supporters, and he gets enabled, A, by those Republicans, and B, by the Trump media friends, if you will, whether it's on the internet or some other television networks. And, you know, it's hard to argue with President Obama's case that it is dangerous. It is dangerous for millions of people to think they can ignore and, in fact, just deny the facts of the results of their election. And I do think the constant Trump attacks on institutions, his own intelligence community, government, and now the very basic elements, the building blocks of democracy, it's troubling, without a doubt.
When you say things like that, you know what some folks on the other side would say, and particularly Trump supporters in particular, they will say, look, this is another example of a quote-unquote mainstream media going after President Trump. They've never liked him. They've always tried to take him down. They've finally done it, and now they're trying to kick him out the door. I know you personally. I know you work exceptionally hard to take it down the middle, but there is a sense in the news media coverage, and I think we're part of it as well, in which we are saying about a president of the United States that he has just lied or he has participated in misinformation or disinformation. But can you explain to folks why that's happening, and does that mean that the news media is against President Trump?
It does not. It does not. And I think we need to be dispassionate when we go through this. You know, the president very much liked my work at the Magic Wall on election night 2016. He did not question the math then because he won. And so I think we should be dispassionate. We should understand this is a political strategy. It's a very old political strategy, as old as the Republic, in fact, older than the Republic. It was used in other places before it was brought here to the United States. He does put it on steroids. And I think that our job in the media is to defend our brand and defend our personal brands by just simply stating the facts. And so if the president says something that's not true, lay out dispassionately and calmly the facts. What I often say is to Trump supporters, you know, pick this up. You can do this at home. You can do it at home. And then, you know, then you can find out that I'm telling you the truth. If I'm not, don't ever watch again. Change the channel. In the case of this election, I'm not trying to undermine the president. I'm trying to tell you that the math simple math, the most basic thing we learned in school a long time ago, says he lost Pennsylvania by more than 50,000 votes, that he's losing Georgia by more than 14,000 votes, that he lost Arizona by more than 11,000 votes. He lost Michigan by 148,000 plus votes. When you add them all up, Joe Biden is going to have somewhere in the ballpark of 306 electoral college votes, assuming he keeps Georgia. That makes him president. That is nothing against President Trump. It's math. It's the rules. It's what happened.
This country is more divided than ever. And in the Congress, we have folks who are openly calling each other names. There's an incivility that didn't exist in the past. Joe Biden has suggested that he, because of his relationships in the Senate, will be able to bring folks together to get things done. Is there any evidence that you've seen in your conversations with Republicans in the Congress and with people in Washington that he'll be successful or not?
There's nothing I've seen yet. I do think we should keep an open mind about this because it is Joe Biden's DNA. And he does have relationships of trust with a lot of the Republicans who are still in the United States Senate, including the Majority Leader Mitch McConnell, who right now, again, refuses to acknowledge that Joe Biden is the president-elect of the United States. But they do have a relationship of trust dating back to Biden's days in the Senate and Biden's days as vice president, when President Obama would often send Vice President Biden up to cut a deal with McConnell. They don't agree on much, but they trust each other. Their word was good back in the Obama administration. Will it be in a Biden administration? That's one of the big dramas. That's why I'm not getting worse yet. There are many more dramas ahead of us here. So we should keep an open mind. But Washington has changed a lot, even in the 4 years since Joe Biden left the White House, in the sense that, this is Trump's Republican Party now. It's not Mitch McConnell's Republican Party. Division is part of the Trump trademark. There's also a broader problem, Frank. Trump didn't create this environment. He did, I think, expand it. Like I said, he puts everything on steroids. But the disaffection was here before Trump. That's why he's president. He didn't create that. The polarization was here before Trump. He may have exacerbated it to try to use it to his advantage because that's how he plays, but it was here before him. I think, and you've gone through this laboratory in California, one of the biggest problems is the way we draw House districts in the United States, where if you're a Democrat or Republican in the House of Representatives, there's 435 of them, maybe 40 of them in any given election year have to worry about the general election. It's all about the primary for them. And so they become more liberal or more conservative because of the nature of the business, if you will. So I was talking earlier about how I'm not against the president. I follow the rules and I follow the math. I do think one of the rules that could be looked at is how we draw House districts. I think it has created the polarization and exacerbated the polarization.
You say this is President Trump's Republican Party. Typically after an election, there is a postmortem that takes place within the party to say, what did we do right? What did we do wrong? President Trump is going to lose this election by more than 5 million votes in the popular vote. Will it remain President Trump's party, or will people who are on the more toward the middle side of this party start to regain it?
I think that, again, is one of the great questions and dramas for the next year. There will be some Republicans who try to step out from under the tent and say, we need a new Republican Party. We need our old Republican Party back. There will be. But you mentioned, Joe Biden won the popular vote by more than 5 million votes. Donald Trump still has the second highest vote total ever for a candidate running for president of the United States, well in excess of 70 million votes. He's a one-term president. We haven't had one of those since George H.W. Bush. Will Trump run in 4 years? I don't know. But will he hold open the prospect of running in 4 years? You bet. He's going to try to keep this party under his thumb. And so the fear factor is very real. Will there be some Republicans who say, no, I will fight you for the Republican Party? There might be a couple. That person better have a backbone. They better have better to plant their feet very strong on the ground, because whether you like President Trump or not, he has proven himself. I call him the human chainsaw on Twitter. Look what he did in 2016. I mean, that was a hostile takeover of the Republican Party. The candidates running against him back then had somewhere in the ballpark of 170 years combined elective political experience. He had never run for anything before, and he bulldozed them. So he's not going anywhere. Will there be a fight in the Republican Party? Yes. How grand will it be? I don't know.
All right. We're going to take a short break. When we come back, I want to ask John King, what's next in Washington, and what's next for John King? We're back with CNN's John King. John, after watching and being in Washington for so many years and as we wrap up another election, your ninth presidential election, are you optimistic about Washington, pessimistic, or keeping an open book? How would you describe it?
I'm fascinated by the question of what comes next. I have an open book about it. Look, you have not only a transition of power, but one party to another. So on issues like taxes and health care, a COVID pandemic, will we get targeted lockdowns? Will Biden try to push a national mask mandate? What will they do about trying to build on Obamacare? We'll have a brand new climate change policy, but can he sell it in the Congress? A whole new American place in the world where Joe Biden rejoins the Paris Climate Accord, starts hugging NATO again instead of shoving it away. There's so much change coming, Frank. I'm fascinated to watch it all play out. That doesn't mean Joe Biden will get everything he wants done. He's still going to have a very evenly divided Senate, no matter who's in charge. But when you have a complete turnover like this, it's always fascinating. Mm.
People are also fascinated with John King. I've known you for many years. I know your work. People in Washington know your great work. People in politics know your great work. Now you're a household name, and not just in America. I mean, overseas as well. People know who John King is. Can I just ask you on a personal level, what does that feel like?
It's gratifying, but I don't think it's so much about me as about the compliments in social media and the like have all been very gratifying, and I'm grateful. I work hard, and I'm glad that people trust me on election nights. But I really think it's much more so, you know, kids on TikTok, people in Ireland asking, where did I come from? Where did my family come from Ireland? That's intensity in the election. People around the world were watching this election. Young people were motivated to get involved in this election. That's a good thing. That has nothing to do with John King. I just happened to be there, and they trusted me to guide them on election night, and I'm grateful for that trust. But to me, it's much more the intensity around the world and across the United States in this election. And I just hope the people who are so energized and engaged keep that. Keep that. Government's less sexy. It's less exciting. But it's more important, actually.
Well, John, we appreciate your hard work, and we appreciate your time a week after this election to be able to spend some time with you. Thank you very much.
Be well, my friend.
And I want to thank you for watching. We'll see you next time.